It's good to see you here tonight. We welcome you here to our Sunday evening service, but it's a very special one. It's our annual Christmas concert, and I'm so glad that you came to join us tonight, and you're going to have a wonderful time. You're going to experience something that's really good. I want to say to the choir, y'all did a fantastic job yesterday. I was really, really thrilled and proud of you. Wonderful job. The orchestra sounds like an orchestra ought to sound. And it was wonderful, and you're going to see that, and you're going to enjoy what they're going to be doing here tonight. Now, first of all, though, I want to make sure everybody has a copy of the program, and if you do not have one right now, please hold up your hand, and the ushers will serve you right now. Everybody needs to have one of these, and just keep your hand up for a second, and they'll find you and give you a copy of our program. Now, this is our Sunday evening service, normally, and we always take an offering. And I'm not trying to raise money out of people who don't come to our church. Our members support this church wonderfully. Of course, if somebody who's not a member throws in, you know, some money, we don't mail it back to you now. But we're not telling you can't give, but we're telling you you're not obligated to give. We support our church very well here, but we need to take our Sunday evening offering. So ushers, can you take your place again, please? And some of you guys are too big a hurry. Sit down. Keep having to get you up. Okay. We're just going to pass the plates through without any other ado tonight. If you brought your Sunday evening offering, well then drop it in the offering plate as it comes by. And while they're doing that, let me tell you about this program. This program has a detachable portion to it here. And if you would fill that out and put your contact information there, I'd love to contact you, get to know you, and thank you for your presence here. And you will notice there are four boxes on the tear-off. And one of them is that you would say at the end of the program, I just prayed to receive Christ. Or I want to talk to somebody from the church about my relationship with Christ. Put my name on your special mailing list, and if you would just detach that, and then as you go out the door tonight, drop or hand it to the usher. The usher will be standing at the door, and he will collect these, and we just love to know you and to have an opportunity to contact you if you would do that for us, please. While they're finishing up with the offering also, we have an annual food drive here, and through the years, we have kept real careful tabs on it. We've now collected over 100 tons, about 108 or 10 tons, believe it or not, of food that we have distributed. Last year, remember, there was a big tornado, just completely demolished a little town up in Kentucky. Well, we sent a whole rider truck full of food up there to help those people and fed them at the First Baptist Church there in that community. So when you give your food, you're going to help people somewhere. A lot of it goes to local agencies here, the Lighthouse, the House of Hope, ministries like that in our local area. If you didn't bring food tonight, then I would like to invite you to bring it sometime between now and next week or so. There's a drop-off point at the north end of the church building here over here on the Zaxby side. If you will drop the food there, then we'll be able to distribute it to the appropriate people throughout the holiday season. And again, thank you for your participation in bringing that. Well, if you have children and they cry, if you would take them out to the foyer, there's screens out there you can watch and you can see, and everybody else will be able to enjoy the program without interruption. And the last thing is, we didn't get to do this last night. We walked out the door and it started raining. But tonight, out in our sower area on the front of the building here, the sower garden, we call it, there's going to be hot chocolate. And a lot of it, and you can really enjoy it. Just come and fellowship, and I'll be out there. I'd like to meet some of you folks who are visiting with us. And just enjoy a good cup of hot chocolate before you go home tonight, and some warm fellowship as well. I think that's it, and I think we're about to begin here. So listen. Begin with a word of prayer, please. Join me as we pray. Almighty God and Heavenly Father, I come to you tonight, Lord, to thank you that we can gather here in your house and we can usher in the Christmas season with this concert of beautiful music and the story of Christ in the gospel. And so tonight, Lord, I pray you will use this program. I know that beautiful Christ-centered music inspires people. It lifts their spirits and encourages them. You made us to enjoy music, and so tonight, help us to just really feast our souls here with the music that is provided for us. And then I ask you, Lord, to use this season to focus upon the Lord Jesus Christ to remind people of what this is about. May we truly be Christ-focused during this time of year. And I pray if there's someone here tonight, they never accepted the Lord Jesus as their Savior and Lord, I pray that they, during this season, will be convicted of their need and that they will trust the Savior. Now, Lord, thank you for our musicians, our choir members, for Jim, for the children who will be singing, for the soloist and quartet and all the different groups. Thank you for each of these people that they would come and work for weeks on end to make this occur. We pray this all in Jesus' name, that you will bless them and use them tonight. Amen and amen.
Come on. we've been learning at the Baptist Temple to sing with the Song of Emmanuel song, and we've sung it every night in the month of November, and just so we can sing it here at our Christmas program. So what I would like you to do, if you know the song, sing along with us. If you don't yet know the song, I want you to just get a feel for it and then just come on and sing along with us. But you got to stand up to do it if you're able to. So let's have everyone stand at this time and let's do Sing Me the Song of Emmanuel.
This dark Christ who was born for us all. Bethlehem, how still we see thee light. Above thy deep and dreamless sleep, the silent stars go by. Yet in thy street shining, the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years of bed, thee tonight will be the we'll sing the Jesus.
Thank you.
Most of the guys did well. There were a few that are in question, but you're more than welcome to join us come the 8th of January when we start rehearsals again. I think the Baptist Temple Quartet is ready, and they're going to come sing a fun song. Give them a welcome, please.
See what's happening in the bar. Come and see.
Christmas is just about that. He has come for us, the Messiah, born to give us life. The Bible tells us about that in two separate passages, one in the Gospel according to Matthew, the first book of the New Testament, and one in the book of Luke, the third book, Matthew, Mark, Luke, the third book of the New Testament. Luke's passage is found in chapter number 2, and what I would like for us to do now is read the first several verses of Luke chapter 2 responsively. And that means simply that I'm going to read the words in white, and I'm going to ask that you read the words in yellow, all together. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed.
And this taxing was first made by Sardinus, the governor of Syria.
And all went to be taxed, every one into his own city.
Thank you. Welcome the King.
this began in a little village about 90 miles north of Jerusalem. It was called Nazareth. And Nazareth was a village. It was probably a population of 400 or 500 people. So everybody knew everybody. It was very poor. It was in the Galilee part of Israel, which was the poorest part of it economically. And you know the story. The angel came and spoke to a little girl, a virgin girl named Mary. Now, this angel came and told her the news that she was going to be the mother of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the long-awaited Messiah. She would have only been 15 or 16 because that was the age of marriage at that time in Israel and in the ancient world. We know that she was a pure girl. The Bible emphasizes her virginity. So we know that she was moral. We also know that she would have been very simple because that was a very simple place. It was not one of the sophisticated capitals of the world. Just hardworking people who made a living and who barely scraped by. Nazareth and the Galilee were known for their poverty in that day. And the Bible says she was espoused to a man named Joseph. And the espousal was a betrothal, or it was an engagement, if you will. But in those days, engagement was much more a serious proposition than it is today. Today, people get engaged and don't think a lot about it. It's not a very serious thing with many people. But in those days, it was tantamount to marriage. It was a legally binding thing back in the Bible days. And so this man, Joseph, the village carpenter, which again means he was a working man. He was a poor man. He was not among the elite of the nation, certainly. And the angel came and spoke to Mary and told her this. In fact, I'm just going to read it to you from Luke chapter number 1. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel came in unto her and he said, "Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with you. Blessed art thou among women." When she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. The angel said unto her, "Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. Behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. He shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end." Then said Mary unto the angel, "How shall this be, seeing I know not a man?" And the angel answered and said unto her, "The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also, that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God." But the angel also visited with Joseph. It's not recorded in Luke, it's over in the book of Matthew. And the angel there told him, "Look, Joseph, it's a little tiny village. Everybody's going to know that she's pregnant. You're going to be highly embarrassed. And you might even be considering breaking the espousal, the engagement. But don't do that, because she's carrying a baby that's the Son of God. And so you go ahead and marry her." So Joseph married her. He took her to wife, it says in Matthew. And then the call came from Rome that there was going to be a census. The emperor in Rome had decided he needed more tax money. And the way to get it was to register every male citizen of the Roman Empire and see if he could increase his revenue stream. And so every male had to go to his ancestral home. And In Joseph's case, this was the city of Bethlehem. It was 90 miles away. The normal time to walk that would have been about 1 week. And so he began that journey with his new wife, Mary. And they made the trip down to Jerusalem over the next several days. The Bible gives us no details about the trip. They arrived, and as the fellows just sung, you ought to see what was happening in the barn, because there was no room for them to check into the inn. And the innkeeper said, I'm sorry, I understand your wife is expecting. The only thing I can do is put you in the cattle barn. Just stop and think about that. Is that not amazing? That the one who spoke the universe into existence, Genesis 1, 1 and 2, now that he came to visit this earth, and the only place we have for him is a barn. He was born there. The Bible says she wrapped him in swaddling clothes, clean clothes, like maybe towels or old blankets or soft clothing that they would wrap the little baby in for warmth and comfort. And she laid him in a manger. Well, it wasn't a pretty one like this, I guarantee you. It was one where the cattle ate their food. And there in that dirty old barn, and in that manger lay the Son of God. What condescension that showed us, we will never, ever understand. The humility of Jesus Christ to come and put himself in that kind of position, we'll never be able to comprehend that kind of humility. That stepping down, if you will, that our Lord showed us when he came to this earth. And so there he was born. A mile away, it's called the Shepherd's Fields. I've been there. And it's just a big field. And the shepherds that were keeping their sheep looked up. There was a commotion in the heavens. And they looked up and there was a chorus of angels singing, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill to men. And then the angel spoke to the shepherds. He said, go into the city and see what's happening there in the barn. And they went and they saw the Lord Jesus Christ. They really saw a family. They saw a family. Mary, Joseph, and the newborn baby. Isn't it interesting that when our Lord came to the earth, he didn't come in any other form. He came and joined a family. The family is God's most important institution, his first institution. And there was a mother, and there was a father, and there was a little boy. God defined for us what a family is right there. And so Jesus was a part of a family. He grew up. The Bible says in the book of Mark that he had four younger brothers, and he had sisters, so there was at least two sisters, big family of at least seven children. And he grew up there in Nazareth, in that poor area, learning from his stepfather how to be a carpenter, working with his hands. And there our Lord was prepared for his ministry. And you know the rest of the story, how he lived a perfect life, and how he performed those miracles to prove that he was, in fact, the divine Son of God. And then he went to the cross. And on the cross, the Father laid upon him the sins of all mankind. Every sin I have ever committed was laid upon Jesus. Every sin you have ever committed was laid upon Jesus. And the Bible says that all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one of us to our own way. We've done what we wanted to do in life. We've broken his law. We've sinned. And the Bible says that God took all that sin of all of humanity and he laid it on the back of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now listen to me. It was God who punished Jesus Christ. Yes, the Romans carried out the deed. Yes, the Jews were chanting, crucify him, crucify him. But it was the Father who chose to bruise him, Isaiah chapter 53. And why did God do that? Because he was punishing my sin and your sin in Christ, our substitute. Amen. Don't ever forget, the one word that describes the Christian faith, perhaps better than any, at least the gospel, is the word substitute. That Jesus bore our sins in his body on the cross. That with his stripes we are healed. That though we like sheep have all gone astray, the Father laid our sins upon him. Jesus willingly and voluntarily took those sins, suffered in our place, and died for us. That's the good news. That's the whole story of Christmas and the reason for Christmas in just a few words. Now, tonight, if you've never received Christ as your Savior, everything that we do at this church is geared toward helping people either find the Lord, or once they find him, to grow in him, to mature in their Christian faith. We emphasize teaching the Word of God. We emphasize people coming to know Christ in a personal way. And it all started in Bethlehem long ago. And it all was completed at the cross 33 years later. And now today, the gift of salvation is offered to every one of us. The Bible says, by grace, you can be saved through faith, meaning when we cease doing anything ourselves to save ourselves, when we seek to save ourselves by our own works, the Bible says that's like filthy rags in God's sight. He's abhorred by it. When we stop trusting ourselves and put our faith, our confidence, our reliance, our dependence upon Jesus Christ, then Bible says he saves us from our sins. He forgives us. He comes into our life. I hope that you know him tonight. The gospel has been sung in various forms here, several different ways tonight. All these songs contain parts of the gospel. I've tried to fill in the blanks for you here in a few moments and tell you the rest of the story. It might be that God brought you to this church tonight so that you could find the Lord Jesus Christ in your life. I want you to bow your head with me right now in prayer. Will you do that? And here's what I want to ask you to do. I want you to search your heart. I want you to ask yourself the question, if I were to die right now, God forbid, I don't want anybody to, but it could happen. If I were to die, do I absolutely know, based upon the scripture, that I would go to heaven to be with the Lord? If you don't know that, you can complete that transaction right now as we sit here in this building. The gospel is that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord, they shall be saved. No ifs, ands, or buts about it. If you in faith, believing, trusting, depending upon Christ and what he did for you, if you put your confidence in him, the Bible says you'll have everlasting life. If you've never been saved, I'm going to lead you in the prayer. I'm going to stop and let you pray following what I do and pray with me. Repeat these words. Now, prayer doesn't save you. Jesus is who saves you. His death on the cross, his shed blood is what brings forgiveness of sin. But this is the way you receive God's gift, is through this prayer. Right now, with our heads bowed, you've never been saved. I want you to pray with me. Heavenly Father, I realize tonight I need Christ as Savior. I also realize I'm helpless to save myself. And I've heard the good news. Jesus died on the cross in my place. He bore my sins and suffered the penalty that I deserve. As best I know how, I receive him into my life right now to be my Savior and my Lord. Cleanse me of my sins. Give me, Lord, eternal life. You promised it by grace through faith. I trust you now. Amen. If you prayed that prayer with me, in a moment when we close our program, I want you to take that detachable portion here and put your name and then check that first box. I just now prayed to receive Christ as my personal Savior. And hand it to one of the ushers. If you'll give us the contact information, I and one of our pastoral staff will contact you within this week. And we want to talk to you and I want to help. You don't have to join this church. You have to do what I talked about tonight if you plan to go to heaven. You've got to have Jesus as your Savior. And this is a great opportunity for you to do it. And if you need further help or have questions, just call the church here and one of us will respond. This is our business. A fellow said to D.L. Moody one time when he was witnessing to him, he said, I wish you'd mind your business. Mr. Moody said, I am minding my business. This is my business. My business is to point people to Jesus Christ. And that's my business, and we want to help you. We want to do business with you as well. Well, Jim, I believe we have another song here, a great song, I might add. And then afterward, we're going to go and drink some hot chocolate, I hope you. So listen to our part.
But before we do, thank you, Pastor. But before we do, there's a verse in the Bible, in the New Testament, in the book of 1 John, chapter number 4, and verse number 14, that says, the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. And if there's nothing else that you remember from our time together this evening, I would love for you to remember all through this Christmas season, the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. And if you don't know that Savior, like our pastor said, our church is here to help you do that. Contact us. Let us know. He meant everything he said about that's why we're here. Say that with me. The Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. Here we go. The Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. One more time. The Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. Thank you. Thank you so very much for being with us this evening in December. God bless you. Have a Merry Christmas. And before you go, get a cup of hot chocolate.